possession.
You shall break them with a rod of iron,
and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel.
Now therefore, O kings, be wise.
Be warned, O rulers of the earth.
Serve the Lord with fear,
and rejoice with trembling,
for his wrath is quickly kindled.
Blessed are all who take refuge in him.
Glory
be to the Father, and to the Son,
and
to the Holy Spirit,
as
it was in the beginning,
is now,
and will be forever. Amen.
Behold my servant whom I uphold,
my chosen in whom my soul delights.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
the mercy and the peace of God, our Heavenly Father, and our Lord Jesus Christ, be and abide with each one of you.
Amen.
Well, it just seems as though a week or so ago, we had the baby Jesus in front of us, and we were putting up Christmas trees and poinsettias and things like that, and now suddenly we're taking them all down, and strangely enough, in the readings of the church, and in the church year, it changes that quickly as well. Only it even numbs us as we see how much of a change takes place in the course of just a few days. You know, the 25th of December, of course, was the celebration of our Lord's birth. And then, right after that, we had him in some of the readings where he was in the temple at 12 years old. Thursday, we had the wise men coming to see the baby and his mother in Bethlehem. And now today, 30 years have jumped. 30 years.
If you want.
We just never can get rid of that, can we? Let me tell you. Okay. Can I go on now? Okay, good. So today we are celebrating the baptism of our Lord Jesus. You know, on this first Sunday after the Epiphany. 30 years have passed already in the course of 2 weeks. And so here you've got no longer the baby in Bethlehem or the young boy in Nazareth, of which we know very little about his life except that 12-year-old experience when his parents took him for Passover to the temple in Jerusalem. And here, this carpenter's son had a greater mission than could ever been imagined by anyone else except him, of course. He came to seek and to save the lost. Even though he learned the trade of being a carpenter, he worked best and perfectly with two pieces of wood, those crossed together. Now he came seeking out his cousin John the Baptizer, the son of old Zechariah and Elizabeth, who was a kinswoman of Mary, the mother of Jesus, who they first met when they were both in the womb, when John the Baptist was 6 months old in the womb of Elizabeth, and Jesus was extremely new in the womb of Mary. And they met together at the home of Zechariah and Elizabeth. Now here the adult Jesus came ready for his appointed ministry. A ministry of redemption. A ministry placing himself under the curse of the law. His ministry of being the sinless sin bearer. Today, we are led to see, especially more clearly, the reason for Jesus' birth. His coming is not just a matter of past history. His coming is an impact upon our present and our future. For he is the Messiah of all time, the past, present, and future. The writer of the Hebrews said it so beautifully and so simply, words that you memorized from the time you were a child. Jesus Christ is saying, yesterday, today, and forever. That is the Christ that we're talking about today. When the time was just right, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under law, to redeem those under law, that we might become the children of God. Jesus placed himself under the law given through the ages, and he had come now to fulfill all righteousness. To do this, he searched out John the Baptizer. He traveled from Galilee in the north to southern Judea. That's where John was baptizing. And as he approached John, John recognized him for who he was. Not as a cousin, that Jesus from Nazareth, but as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This was the one that John had just talked about to the people. There comes one after me. He said, I am not the Messiah. I am not the Christ. But one who comes after me, I am not even worthy to untie his sandal straps. Here Jesus comes, the Lamb of God, recognized now by John. And he identifies with all people who need forgiveness. John knew that Jesus didn't need to be baptized. And even more, John at first, if you remember the gospel reading, tried to stop him. I need to be baptized by you. That's when Jesus reminded him, let it be so now. For thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Trusting the plan, John consented. Jesus submitted himself under the law, underwent the baptism of repentance, not for his forgiveness of sins, because he is the sinless Lamb of God. He was baptized for us, as if he were a sinner, willingly submitting himself in our place, identifying with sinners like us, and for sinners of all time. His baptism was a kind of anointing. As kings and prophets were anointed in Israel, his baptism was also an anointing to set him apart for a divine task. And to reaffirm this, you saw the dove descending upon him, the Holy Spirit, and the voice of the Father, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. As Jesus submitted under baptism to take on the sins of the world, he became Israel in one person. At his baptism, Jesus began his ministry, and his mission involved totally forgiveness. Forgiveness not for his sin, as I said, he was a sinless Lamb of God, but forgiveness for the sins of all human beings. He who knew no sin, Paul wrote, became sin for us. In that baby of Bethlehem, God sent forth his beloved Son. For God so loved the world that he sent forth his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And here is that only begotten, beloved Son, now submitting himself under the law, starting the journey to the cross. This Messiah is chosen servant, as Isaiah said, the servant with whom God is well pleased. The one chosen to be his sacrifice for all sin, for all time. Jesus' baptism was to fulfill all righteousness. And that fulfillment of God's plan began there at the Jordan River. Jesus' mission moves from the Jordan to the wilderness, that short stopover in the wilderness where he contended with the devil for 40 days and 40 nights, being tempted in every way for our sakes. And from that wilderness, on to Jerusalem, and then to us, taking away our sin, basically serving as our garbage man, so to speak, carrying all the garbage of our life to the cross with him, and then burying it and leaving it in the tomb. You know, in 70 AD, some of you may recognize that date as the date when the Romans destroyed the city of Jerusalem. They were just fed up with it. They were tired of the rebellious attitude and the arrogance of the Jews, and so they just got tired of dealing with them, and so they decided to destroy, teach them a lesson, and teach all those in the Middle East a lesson as well. And so they destroyed Jerusalem in 70 AD, destroyed that beautiful temple that King Herod the Great had built, destroyed the palaces and everything else in the city, and many people died in that. And they didn't just stop with Jerusalem, but they went to the outlying villages as well, killing anybody that they termed was a zealot, someone who was trying to overthrow Rome. In one of these villages, a rabbi's son was killed brutally by the Romans. And this rabbi in the synagogue bitterly complained as he prayed. He said, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you created our body, but you never had your blood poured out. You have no body to ache and to die. You have not experienced human grief. You ask us to love you. How can we love you? How can we believe in your love for us if you do not share our human suffering? That's sad, because the Messiah who submitted himself under the waters of baptism, submitting himself under the curse of the law for our sakes, did every one of those things, poured out his blood for us, suffered and died for us. He experienced all that we experienced. He ate, he suffered, he bled, he died for the sins of the world. Christ came to reveal God's grace to us, to reveal this type of a Savior. The Apostle Paul writes, "Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus." Jesus came to usher in the kingdom of God, not with a blast of trumpets, but with moans and groans from the cross of Calvary. By his sacrificial work on the cross and by his glorious resurrection, he ushered in the kingdom of God. In our baptism, we are also members of that kingdom. We then are placed under the waters of baptism in order for us to be raised up as new creations. We are God's people, saved by grace. We bear his name, and we also bear the claim that he has on us. In our baptism, the Apostle Paul says, we participate in the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead, through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. All of that impacts who we are and how we live today. In our baptism, we are empowered to live a new life, a life that is expressed especially in the way in which we are called by God to love him, to love our neighbors, and to love one another as well. How do we do this? By sacrificially reaching out to them, sacrificially living our life in joy, knowing that by his grace, we have been claimed as his people. You know, in 1847, a guy by the name of Dr. James Simpson discovered something that we don't hear much about today. It was chloroform. Now, it's a painkiller, as some of you may know. It was something that was unknown. Before that, it was biting the bullet. Well, you remember, biting the bullet and a switch, you know, and then they would operate, right? All right, so, you know, prior to that, it's about all they had. And chloroform came as a painkiller to knock people out, especially as they were undergoing surgery, and especially as they were working on amputations in the battlefield. It was quite a monumental change to the medical profession, indeed. And while lecturing at the University of Edinburgh, a student asked him, "What is the most valuable discovery of your life?" Duh. You know, what are you going to answer? What are you going to answer? But he answered in a way that the student was totally surprised. He said, "My most valuable discovery was when I discovered that I was a sinner, and that Jesus Christ was my Savior." It hasn't changed. It hasn't changed in all those years. We are still sinners, and Jesus Christ is our Savior. He who went under the waters of baptism is the one who also then takes us under the waters of baptism so that we might rise up as his children in the world. In Jesus' name. Now may that peace that surpasses all human understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let's continue now by standing and confessing our Christian faith in the words of the ancient Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the As we have received this righteousness by our baptism into death, make us bold in faith and fervent in love that we may live out heavenly lives even in this world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, as you have opened heaven to your church through holy baptism, give your faithful teachers to proclaim your Son, Jesus Christ, and all that accords with godliness, that many would repent of their sins and join him in his heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty Father, you break the wicked with your rod for the sake of your beloved children. Help us at all times to serve you with fear and to seek refuge always in the kingdom of your Son. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, your Son Jesus is the true Christ and the true King of this world. Grant great humility to the rulers of the nations that they would submit to the preaching of his holy word for the sake of their own souls and for the good of your own people. Protect our troops, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, you sent your Son to serve your people and deliver them from sin and death. Because we long for your salvation, bring us out of our afflictions and uphold all those bruised in spirit. We pause for a moment of silence as we bring to you those who are weighing upon our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In holy baptism, you have opened the heavens to your children. Grant that all those baptized into your Son would worthily receive the heavenly feast of his body and blood for their forgiveness, life, and salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, you manifested yourself with the Holy Spirit in the fullness of grace at the baptism of your dear Son. With your voice, you directed us to the one who has borne our sins, that we may receive grace and forgiveness. Keep us, we implore you, in the true faith, since we have been baptized in accordance with your command and the example of your Son. Strengthen our faith by your Holy Spirit and lead us to everlasting life and salvation through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We come before the Lord to receive his gifts and grace that he offers to us in a very real and special way as he brings to us his very body and blood veiled in earthly elements of bread and wine for us to eat and to drink, to strengthen our faith in him and also to reaffirm we are his forgiven children. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, for what had been hidden from before the foundation of the world, you have made known to the nations in your Son, in him being found in the substance of our mortal nature, you have manifested the fullness of your glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Send your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name of the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us to do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same manner also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we drink, eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom. We've already prayed this, Lord, so accept our prayers. And now let us sing together the Agnus Dei. Take drink the blood of Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Forgiven now by his grace, go in his peace. Amen.
Shed for you, Jesus.
strengthen you and keep you of the true faith until life everlasting. Depart in the Lord's peace. Amen. Let's stand to sing our Thank the Lord. Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace.
Amen.
Survived the service today. Go in God's peace, everyone. Happy Epiphany.